Adopting the assessment for a period of 1 year at 3.5% interest rate.
Okay. We have a motion by Greg Schultz to approve for 1 year at 3.5% interest. Do you have a second to that?
Second.
Second by Brent Svenby. Any further discussion there?
What happens if they're not paid during the year?
They're added to the taxes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. This is adding them to their taxes.
And then what if it's foreclosed property?
Then on their tax bill.
At the time it's sold, it would have to be taken care of.
Yes.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Any other comments or questions?
Would it be the same thing in the event of a death? I noticed one name on there. That person is deceased. Has been for a couple years.
Yeah. Right. This will file as an assessment against that property, transfer of ownership. They're assuming that property knowing that it's on those taxes.
Okay. Thank you.
Until it's transferred out of his name, it still has to be legally recorded for him.
The assessment attaches to the property, not the person.
Yeah. Right.
Any other questions or comments? See none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? This has been approved. That is Resolution 67-14. Moving on to finance report, and we'll ask Greg to read the financial report.
Yes, I'll give a recap of checks over 20,000. They are $104,446 to the Commissioner of Transportation for the purchase of the MnDOT land related to the Dykin Pond. $24,955 to Bolton and Mink for the airport master plan. $191,010 to Bornicky Construction for the Northwest Industrial Pond. $139,021 to Crane Creek Asphalt for hot mix. $20,852 to DMC Plumbing and Heating for the wastewater treatment plant boiler replacement. $21,000 to Ellingson Company for the wastewater treatment plant cured in place pipe liner. $41,000 to Malo Roofing to re-roof the American Legion. That's through a Small Cities Development Program grant. $98,938 to Minger Construction for 2013 street and utility project final payment. Other expenditures of $147,239 for total expenditures presented for approval of $788,463.80.
Thank you, Greg. You've all heard the report. What is your comments or questions?
Motion to approve.
We have a motion by Bill Thompson to approve. Do we have a second?
Second.
We'll go with Dave Burbank on this one. Second by Dave Burbank. Any further discussion there? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? This has been approved also. Moving on to the comment, the consent agenda items, which are minutes of meetings, the license permit requests, board and commission reports, department reports, etc., all grouped into one motion. What is the council's wishes on this?
Motion to approve.
We have a motion by Bill Thompson to approve. That is the addition of that.
With the addition, yes.
Okay, we have a motion by Bill. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Greg Schultz. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? This has been approved also. Moving down to action items, 3.3.1, wine, and 3.2, on sale license for Shenfeng Mizuki Fusion. And this will go to Chris.
Thank you, Les. The restaurant opened during July of 2011 and ownership has since changed. The new owner is applying for these licenses in their new corporate name, as liquor licenses are not transferable. Lin Feng, the officer of the company, has passed the required background check, and Chief Hiller has recommended approval of the license. We've received from the applicant the current fees of $150 for the on-sale wine license, $100 for the 3-2 malt liquor license, and $100 for the application fee. Wine and beer licenses are not prorated. The current license period will expire on June 30th, 2015. Staff recommends approval of the new license.
Thank you, Chris. Any questions from the council?
Motion to approve.
We have a motion by Greg Schultz to approve. Do we have a second?
Second.
It was me.
Sorry. Motion by Nate to approve, second by Greg. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? This has been approved also. Good luck. Now, with that, we move on to ordinances 3.4.1, second reading of proposed ordinance 1014, Z328 North Cedar Properties Limited. Troy.
Now, this is a request by Brad Spitzak, sorry, representing North Cedar Properties. This is out on School Street, between the railroad tracks, kind of south of Charter Communications there. To rezone the property from B2 Community Business District and R1 Single Family to an R6 High Density Residential District. And that's, the intention is to build a 24-unit apartment building. There are future plans to do more development on the site, but at this point it would be just a single 24-unit apartment building. And we did have the first reading at the last council meeting.
And there's no additions or corrections to that?
That's right. So staff would recommend approval as presented by the Planning Commission.
Thank you, Troy. Questions from the council? What is the council's wishes?
Motion to approve.
Motion by Greg Schultz to approve. Do you have a second to that?
Second.
Second by Bill Thompson. Any further discussion there? Seeing none, this be an ordinance, we ask for roll call.
Councilmember Spenby?
Aye.
Dotson?
Aye.
Thompson?
Here. Aye.
Schultz?
Aye.
Burbank?
Aye.
Rainey?
Aye.
Abraham?
Aye.
We have all seven ayes.
Thank you. This has been approved. This is the last reading of this now, correct?
Correct.
Okay. Moving on to resolutions 3.5.1, resolution 7314, final plat of Seven Stars Edition, and back to Troy.
And this is the plat of the property. There would be one lot platted and three outlots platted as part of this. If you remember from the last meeting, there was much discussion on stormwater in this area and maintaining a drainage way through this property. And in the final plat, we do have a 30-foot utility easement for that drainage way with the stipulation that the property owner is responsible for maintaining that drainage way. So again, staff would recommend approval of the final plat as recommended by the Planning Commission.
Thank you, Troy. Questions from the council?
Troy, do we know where the curb cut would be to access that property on School Street? I've had a call from a concerned party regarding the elevation of that hill there, where it's hard to see as you approach that.
Yep, and we've had some discussions on that as well. It is a county road, and the county approves the location of that driveway, and they have indicated it's gone to the county for approval already. They like to line up driveways with driveways across the street, and I believe this lines up with a driveway across the street. It's down from the peak of that hill. It's more across from, I believe, the sixplex.
Okay, the 1120.
Yep.
Okay.
That being said, I guess I got a concern a little bit there because this would be entering right into the eastbound traffic, which will be cresting the hill. If it was closer to the top where it could be seen from both directions. The other side of the road is entering into the westbound, which is very, the visibility is very clear there. It isn't coming over the hill on the eastbound. So, you know, to me, that would be probably a concern that I would have, so.
The only benefit you've got is you do have a stop sign at the railroad track, so they aren't, shouldn't be up to full speed by that time.
I wouldn't bet on that.
If they stop.
Well, shouldn't be.
Well, ultimately, we have no say in it, correct?
Yes. I mean, the county does have the say on it. But again, I would voice a concern that way. So, thank you. But with that, we are looking for a motion for approval.
So
and
moved.
We have that.
So moved.
We have a motion by Nate.
Second.
Second by Bill Thompson. Any further discussion there? And no further discussion. Ask for all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? This has been approved also. Thank you. Moving on to resolution 7414, authorized parking modification on East Vine Street, and that we will go to Troy.
If you remember in the old Jerry's building there off the Vine Street side, there was a deli, I think it was called Vine Street Deli. that was open for a little while. As part of that business, they did make a request for a parking stall to be a 30-minute stall, just for ease of people coming in and grabbing something and leaving. That business has been closed for a while now, and we still have that 30-minute parking stall there. And so it doesn't need to be changed by council action, and staff recommendation would be to change that back to two-hour parking like it is on the rest of that side of the street. So staff would recommend a resolution changing that one to a 30-minute stall back to a two-hour parking stall. And as things develop with that vacant property, you know, there might be a need to modify it again at some point in time, but for the short term and for the immediate future, that's probably better used as a two-hour parking stall rather than a 30-minute stall.
Thank you.
Motion to approve.
We have a motion to approve by Kevin Rainey. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Greg Schultz. Any further discussion there? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? This has been approved also. Moving down to the resolution 75-14, set date for public hearing for administration of Small Cities Development Program grant, and that we go to Troy again.
And you should have an updated memo in front of you that was handed out this morning that changed the numbers a little bit there to make those accurate. But the city did receive a Small Cities Development grant for improvements for downtown, as you're well aware. The city is required by conditions of the grant agreement to solicit public comments on the program at application time and at midway through the administration of the program. Small Cities Development Grant is funded through Minnesota Department of Employment and Economic Development for the rental rehabilitation and the commercial rehabilitation within a specified target area, which is downtown. The first 300 blocks of Cedar Avenue, it comes out onto Broadway as well as Bridge Street. We are pretty much at the halfway point there, and so we are requesting setting a public hearing. The grant total was for $470,420 was for improvements to properties, $50,000 was for administration. That will be matched with some loans from the EDA and the HRA to help with these properties meet their match for the grant. So the staff would recommend the council adopt the resolution authorizing a public hearing to accept public comments on the Small Cities Development grant for the rehabilitation of these properties. And we've had probably 10 applications now that we're working with. I will say it is a long process, and they give you 2 years to go through beginning to end, and it usually takes the full 2 years to get there. There's a lot of requirements, and part of this public comment too is to get some feedback from the applicants to provide to the state to see if they can see where some of the hang-ups might be and see if there might be some modifications to the program, as well as to see, you know, how we're performing in administering the grant. So we would request to set public hearing for the next council meeting, which would be November 18th, I believe.
Make a motion to approve.
We have a motion by Bill to approve this request. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Nate Dotson. Any further discussion here? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? This has been approved. Now moving on to resolution 7614, sanitary sewer service repair at 1213 South Elm Avenue. And this will go to Kyle.
Good evening. As you will recall, Mr. Vizna spoke at the last council meeting in regards to a sanitary sewer repair at his home at 1213 South Elm. We did discuss it with him, and he did petition to have the cost of approximately $9,800 assessed to his property over 10 years at 3.5% interest. We do have that petition from him, and staff is recommending approval.
Thank you, Kyle. Questions from the council?
Motion to approve.
We have a motion by Nate to approve. Do we have a second?
Second.
Kevin.
Second by Kevin. Any further discussion here? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? This has been approved also. Thank you. Moving down to miscellaneous items, 3.6.1, personnel policy updates, and this will go to Lynn.
And I'm always the last one on the agenda.
That's for last.
Yes, all right. Thank you for having me tonight, and I ask that you approve some updates and additions to our policy manual that we have for employees. And most of these are laws that have been signed into place that we need to have in our policy. I'll go through them on 4.3 for breaks. This comes from the Women's Economic Security Act that was signed into law by Governor Dayton, and this is for us to allow nursing mother break time. 6.8, fitness and wellness program. We have a policy for fitness and wellness program, but I did want to add our wellness committee that we have started, and it's going great. But we do receive grants from Southeast Service Co-op, where we have our insurance through, and we just want to make sure that all employees are aware of that. So we want to add that to the policy manual. And also 7.5, sick leave. That's another Women's Economic Security Act where we need to allow employees to take time for safety leave. And that is in instances where employees or specified family members have been victims of sexual assault, domestic abuse, or stalking. Another part on the sick leave has to do with defining specified family members. As of right now or previously, we would say that they would have to be legal dependents that they could use their sick leave for, but state law has defined specified family members not only as legal dependents, but also employees, adult child, spouse, sibling, parent, grandparent, step-parent, parent-in-laws, and grandchildren. And also to that, we, according to the new state statute, that we must allow employees to take up to 160 hours per year for specified family members for sick leave. Moving on to 7.11, pregnancy and parenting leave. Again, that's another Women's Economic Security Act signed into law by Governor Dayton, allowing that parental leave previously was 6 weeks, and now they have increased it to 12 weeks. All right, moving on to 7.116, bone marrow donation leave. That is leave that if employees who work 20 or more hours per week on average can take paid leave not to exceed 40 hours to donate for bone marrow. 8.2, gifts and gratuities. Just a statement at the bottom, and what we added with the wellness committee, when we receive grants, we do different types of programs, and some of those programs involve incentives to incent the employees to participate in wellness, and we wanted to make sure that all employees knew that it was okay to receive a gift or an incentive from the City of Owatonna that uses our wellness grant money for that. 8.3, no smoking. This is a very big step for the City of Owatonna, and I am excited to bring this step to you. Right now, for smoking, the only policy that we have is saying that you can not smoke in buildings or vehicles. We want to expand that to buildings, vehicles, and equipment, and also to only allow smoking during designated break times. Now, we understand that this is quite a big step for our employees, and I would like to add a timeline in there, not to make this effective as of tonight, but if we could make that effective as a 1/1/15 and go through the employees, and I want to tell them the resources there are out there for to help them quit smoking through our insurance and other avenues of that. So, yes, Nate.
Would that pertain to non-tobacco products like the e-cigarettes?
Yep, I have included those with chewing tobacco, vaping, e-cigarettes. Yeah, that was another change, because previously it was just, you know, smoking and tobacco, chewing tobacco. So yes, those new products, we want to include those. Yes, Dave.
Do we have a pretty good handle on how many employees do use tobacco?
Well, we know of a couple, but, you know, there are closet smokers, too, that we don't know about. So we don't want to pinpoint any one, you know, employee. So we're going to be, when I hand out the materials for helping stop smoking, I'm going to be giving those to all employees. But I can't give you a specific number.
How do you handle that with a salaried position where, you know, they typically don't take a normal break time?
Right, and that's something that they're going to have to work through with their department head or city administrator on, you know, making sure we're clarifying that, because you're right, and they don't only work 8 hours, they may work 12 hours that day, so we just have to make sure we have a good handle on that. And
won't make any difference if they quit.
That's right.
That's what we hope.
Len, the effective date of 1/1/15, is that only applies to the smoking portion?
Yes, that's the only one. I don't want to drop this on employees and tell them tomorrow, guess what, you only get to smoke during your designated break. So we felt like it would be a good move to do this policy and also try to give them the tools to help smoking. Or help stop smoking, sorry.
I've got a couple concerns. First concern being enforcement of the policy. Mm-hmm. I can't say I have a real big problem if somebody's out mowing the park and they're smoking a cigarette. I don't worry about it too much. So I think we've got the enforcement part of that, which is an issue, and I also worry that we're going to probably prevent people from going down the road of quitting smoking by maybe using an e-cigarette. I mean, I've talked to a lot of people that smoke and they've switched to e-cigarettes. Well, they may not be perfect. They're definitely better than tobacco-based products.
But this includes e-cigarettes, so they can't smoke those.
I know, and I'm worried about that. I would rather we provide some latitude for tobacco alternatives, which an e-cigarette is. So I'm worried that we might prevent people from taking that route if we include those products in the ban. Because I think, I've spoken to enough people who used to smoke cigarettes, now they use e-cigarettes. They are definitely healthier. They're less offensive to people around you. So I just don't want us to discourage people from using those products to get them off of tobacco products.
Chris?
I would just add that I have received complaints from the public when they see our employees smoking out in the parks and that, you know, if you're smoking a cigarette and then you're, you know, you have to dispose of that, and, you know, there's those issues as well.
That's a littering issue. Mm-hmm. So yeah. If they throw their pop can, it's the same thing.
Okay.
The public will not be able to distinguish from a distance the difference between an e-cigarette and a regular cigarette also.
Which I think is part of the reason people want to ban e-cigarettes, because it looks like smoking a cigarette.
Yep. Yep.
Okay. Whether or not that's reasonable is debatable, but... Mm-hmm.
All right, and the last policy I bring to you tonight is 14.4, and that's the driving policy. As of right now, the only driver's license checks that we do on employees are people with commercial driver's license, CDLs, but we have employees that are driving our city vehicles, and also they're driving their own vehicles on work time. And what I ask is for our safety policy that we add this driving policy where we check individual license, that not only if you hold a CDL, but if you're driving a city vehicle or your vehicle during work time, that we check their driver's license every year to make sure that they're valid. And also another addition to that policy is that if employees lose their license or receive restrictions, that we are requiring them to tell their supervisor or department head within the next work day.
Thank you. Any questions from the council?
Question on that.
Kevin.
Are we right now, or are we going to be checking also employees that are driving their own vehicles, making sure that they are fully insured?
We cannot do that. We don't do that now.
So if they're driving their own vehicle on city time and they're not legally insured, where does that liability lie?
Well, that's a good question, and I can check with the League of Minnesota Cities on that.
Mark?
Oh, there. Mark can answer that.
if the employee is on city business, it's
likely that the city's insurer would be on the risk as it would be excess coverage.
Okay, thank you.
There probably would be an argument, though, too. There was a stop at the Dairy Queen, for example.
Any other questions from the council?
Mark, is there anything that can be done to require employees to have insurance, at least make that statement, that they're required to have insurance on their own vehicles?
Well, it's really a matter of compliance with all laws.
Yeah, state laws.
Under Minnesota law, we have mandatory liability insurance.
Yeah, but you know as well as I do, there's a lot of people that don't.
It's true. Right.
And is there something, I'm thinking of employment-wise, that, you know, that if they don't have insurance, they get in an accident, that they can lose their position, or can we require that they provide a copy of their liability insurance to the city?
Let me look into that.
All right.
Let me look into that.
That was a question that I was going to ask, is because I know that my wife worked at Federated. Any insurance coverage of any drivers driving company vehicles, they had to have a good license and standing and have insurance on their own vehicles before they were allowed to drive company vehicles such as city vehicles. So, and then the question would be, is it in event of something happening, the repercussions, you know, what would we be doing and looking at that? And I think you've got it stated here in a case-by-case issue.
Correct. So,
any other comments or questions? Thank you, Lynn. Chair will entertain a motion.
I would make a motion to approve the changes that have been listed here with an addition to the no smoking being effective 1-1 of 2015.
We have a motion by Bill to approve this with that effective date. Any second to this motion?
Second.
Second by Kevin Rainey. Any further discussion on this?
My only request would be that we do make an effort to talk to the employees that do smoke and find out if any of the products that we have restricted would actually help in cessation, and make sure that we're giving them some options that would help rather than hinder that.
Right, I will do my best.
Okay, any other comments or questions? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion's been approved. Thank you very much. Now we move on to public comment, and if anybody in the audience wishes to speak, please come to the microphone. And anything that's not on the agenda, allow 2 minutes to speak. Seeing none, we will move on to council's comment, and we'll start with Brent.
Just tomorrow is election day, so I'll get out and vote.
Yes, good luck. Nate.
And I would wish good luck to everybody running for any office.
Thank you. Bill.
I had the same comment as exercise your right to vote tomorrow.
Thank you. Greg.
Same comment.
Dave.
Same comment from Ward 3.
Thank you. Kevin.
Same comment.
Same comment, yes.
Bill.
Or Tom.
Well, the Exchange Club has been so kind every year is to sponsor the Mayor's Prayer Breakfast, and that is taking place on November 20th at 7:30 a.m. in the Arts Center. And our guest speaker for that will be Larry Kunkel. Tickets are available at the Exchange Club. And I also stopped up to the compost site today, and they informed me that their last day will be November 26th.
Thank you. Chris?
The only thing I have is to remind council we will canvass the votes on Friday at 8 a.m., so I'll need a quorum of y'all.
8 a.m. Friday morning.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. And I have nothing other than get out and vote. And with that, Kevin.
Coffee with Council has been changed
also.
Oh, yes,
thank you. I'm sorry. Coffee with the Council will be on November 22nd at 8:30 at the kitchen.
Thank you. With that, Chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Motion by Kevin Rainey to adjourn. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Brent Svenby. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Meeting adjourned.
I'll be gone.